It's been a wonderful day so far. Okay. I, you know, used to travel a lot from University of Bradford to London during my student period. Okay. And today we start very early and arrive in London on time. And we have the beautiful weather, you know, blue sky and all this, right? It's the, all the memories back. And also, right, you know, I'm really appreciative is that I'm to give me the opportunity to talk about, right, it's the color science, okay? And many, many friends here, we haven't met for a while, okay, but anyway, so let's start the ball rolling. So today, right, it's my aim, right, is I would like to say, is give you a review of the color science, okay? Many of you say, oh, this is boring. But anyway, right, I will also try to give you an up-to-date information, okay, update some, you know, areas of interest. What is the CIE Division 1 we are working at, okay? So I'm a professor of color and imaging science at Leeds, and also I wear another hat, that's the director of the CIE Division 1. So I'm selling Division 1. We need more people, okay? So let's see them, you know, what's the, you know, the recent development. So what is the CIE? Okay, I never good in French, I was in International Commission on Illumination. Okay, so we have 8 different divisions. Okay, so currently, right, the Division 7 is the terminology that's disbanded. Because, right, in the very, very near future, you are going to have your lighting, CIE lighting vocabulary, okay, thank you, available. So everybody can find your, you know, color tones, okay, and from the CIE, you know, vocabulary. This will be in the CIE website, but you cannot download. You can only, you know, find what you require, okay? We have the other 7 divisions we're looking at. Firstly, of course, color and vision, okay? Division 2 is to do with the physical measurement. This is a metrology. How do we measure color light? The most, the hottest topic now is how can we measure the lighting condition in the real lit environment. The environment like this, we like to know the illuminance, you know, distribution in the room, okay? And the LED is also the very, very hot topic. Division 3, 4, 5, we are looking at a very applied area. Division 3, look at the interior. Division 4, looking at the traffic signals and the automobile lightings. And Division 5, exterior, we're talking about the street lighting condition, driving in the dark night, okay? And Division 6, right, it's non-visual. It's to do with little about the color, okay? It's to do with the photobiology and the photochemistry. So it's a lot of the areas, right? How can we apply the lighting to improve the well-being, okay? What is the right lighting to enhance the growing of the plants, for example, okay? And finally, right, it's the imaging technology. Many of you, right, is involved. I think most of the, you know, the big, you know, topic today is the symposiums on color imaging, okay? So my scope, right, is what is color science, right? Basically, we're doing 3 things: the color specification, color difference evaluation, color appearance modeling, and then what we are saying, right, by the end. Is it possible we have a universal color model to look at the world, all the applications? So this is boring, right? It's what is the color science? Everybody say, oh, we measure X, Y, Z, okay? How do we measure it? We need to quantify 3, you know, key elements for perceiving objects, okay? So these are the light source, these are the objects, and our visual systems. So CIE, we define all these elements in terms of the spectral power distribution across the visible wavelengths, okay? So, and once we define this, right, we can then, right, it's just multiplied in wavelengths by wavelengths, and we get the sum, and then what we got, x, y, z values, okay? So in the layman's term, the very easy way to understand is that you have an object, you have a light. I have a reference in the red, green, blue lights in order to match that. So that is, we define the colors in terms of the numerical values, numbers, okay? So, right. So, and then, right, it's, so we have this x, y, z values. We don't understand the meaning of this. So we need a color map. We needed to present these colors, okay, in the what we call the color space. So 1931, 1964, these are the two CIE color systems, okay? So, and basically, right, it's, we can provide the chromaticity coordinates together with the, you know, capital Y, which is the Y transstimulus or luminance factors. This is give us, right, it's the lightness dimension. So all the colors, we can plot them, so we know their relationship, okay? And so now, right, it's, I would like to give you a summary. Okay, what is the CIE we recommend, okay? The first thing, right, is CIE luminance, okay? And then we have light sources. These are the physical object, okay? Physical body emitting light, we call them light source. Illuminance, that means we measure using the telespectral radiometer, say, and then right, we can get its numerical definitions. That is what we call the illuminance, okay? So people ask, right, how many CIE standard illuminance? Strictly speaking, we have two. One is with D65, another one is the illuminant A, okay? So 1964, because the strong demand from the industry, because people were applying a lot of the fluorescent samples, okay? So we know the deficiency of the CIE illuminants, the average illuminant C, okay, and B, they don't have enough, sufficient this and energy in the UV area. So a series of the D illuminants that are being recommended, D55, D50, D65, and D70, okay? So, so we have the two ISO standard illuminants, A, D65. CIE also recommended a different illuminants. This is the typically D65, okay, plotted here. So you can see the right, it's the, this is a sort of right, D65 simulator. A series of fluorescent lamps and high pressure lamps, okay? So many people are familiar with the F1, F12, but now we have the F, you know, FL31 and FL315, okay? This is representing what are the typical lighting used in the real world. And high pressures, we have HP1, HP5, okay? So all this right in the CIE Bible, that's what we call in the CIE Bible, publication 15, 2004. Okay, and I know many students got a copy of that. Okay, highly not recommended. Okay, so now right, it's, we have a color matching function, we have a spectral power distribution, we have the weights. Okay, so this is typically how this the application is all about. So people provide the weights. This is the combination of the particular color matching function together with a spectral power distribution of a light source, okay? So for example, D65, 10 degree, I give you a table. So once you measure your objects using the spectral photometers, you get the reflectance of the, let's say objects is the orange. So you've got this X, Y, Z functions, and then you sum this together. Finally, you've got this X, Y, Z values, okay? So the present CIE work, right, is TC157 is looking at, right, is how can we calculate the X, Y, Z values, okay? So it will be published very, very soon, okay? If you think, oh, it's everybody knows how to calculate the X, Y, Z values, okay? However, if you look at the details, right, the try to get a good agreement between the different instruments and to get an agreed results, you need to looking at an extrapolation, interpolation, bandwidth, okay? So you have 20 nanometer intervals, okay, instrument. How can you get an accurate XYZ values? So this new standard is working on this, okay? It will be published very, very shortly. TC171 is the stimulus integration. This is talking about the abridgment, okay? So the current standard recommending computing weighting table from the 1 nanometer, okay? If you have 10 nanometer instrument, 20 nanometer instrument,
how do you get a good waiting tables? Okay, and then right, it's not, you need you know, various methods being proposed. Okay, so CIE tried to standardize this. Okay, so if you consider a 20 nanometer data using F11, this is in a tri-band, very sharp peak, and you can result in large color differences. Okay, so how can you overcome the problem? There's the need to propose the standardized methods to do it. If you look at the LED, sort of narrow band in the spectrum, all this also could have a big problem. So another area is right, looking at right, is the, what we call the daylight simulators. So for all the people, okay, working in the surface color industry, textile, paint, printing, all this, we applied this, what we call the daylight simulators, okay? You go to the factories, everybody say, I'm using daylight simulators, but you will be really amazed how big the deviation, okay, between them. It's a big variation. The quality of this is not, you know, uniform, okay? So the most widely used methods is the fluorescent lamp, okay? So you use the fluorescent lamp to simulate the D65 in terms of its chromaticity coordinates. The color temperature is right. You also need to get its metamerism index. It's especially provided by the CIE. Okay? So TC144 is recommending what are the available technology to produce the high quality simulators. The top two diagrams show the current technology. One is to use the fluorescent tubes. Okay, and the top right is using the filtered tungsten. The bottom two, or the middle two, spectral power distribution, we are looking at right this other xenon, you know, the daylight simulators, and also the LED. They are coming. They're coming in a very big way. So you can have right, let's say 8 to 12 LEDs. And you can fine tune to any color temperature you require, and to get a very high color, you know, rendering, and also the metamerism index. Okay, the bottom one, right, is the new recommendation on indoor daylight. Okay, so the CIE have a D65 and D50, all this, right. D65 is we're talking about, right, is most of the work being done is from the outdoor. Okay. But once we look at the, you know, the real samples in the room, we are talking about a you know, window block, you know, in between. So the CIE, right, is looking at right, is the TC166, okay, indoor daylight being proposed, okay. So you will have less UV contents. It's sort of not a complete cutoff, partial cutoff of the filters. And also looking at the methods for redefining CIED luminance. Okay, but that this is another activity. Yoon-Ji, okay, the lady who gave the talk this morning, we are looking at right, it's observer metamerism. How observers varies, you know, to match a color. Okay, this is a revisit of the basic color matching function. CIE currently we have a standard deviate observers. We try to understand what is the typical variation between observers. Okay, so Yoon-Ji's work, right, is you know, original work, right, is you know, to look at the variability. Okay, so we're working closely with you know, IIT and looking at different techniques, different people, and what are the variabilities between observers. Okay, so you need the visual colorimeter to carry out the, you know, experimental work. And Yoon-Ji's particular interest, right, is on the matching patches on screen. Okay, a lot of application now for the surface color industry, they design color patches and look at the variabilities. So next one, right, is to do with the vision. In the division one, we have color and the vision, two parts. Okay, the TC136, right, looking at the fundamental chromaticity diagram for physiologically significant axis. So basically what we are saying, right, is the color matching function based on the cone responses, okay? RGB, okay, LMS, okay? And the important thing there, right, is that a color matching function can take into account the field size. Why would we have 2 degree and 10 degree? How about 5 degree? How about 6 degree? Okay? How about the different ages of the observers? Okay? So this TC136, right, worked on a very long time span. It's almost finished now, okay? But they did very careful experimental work, okay? Try to quantify, such as the ocular pigments, okay? What is the variation during the, different age, okay? And also, right, is look at the, how this, variations in field sizes, okay? So the general idea, right, is saying we start with the 10 degree color matching function because that is the believed to be most robust functions, okay? So Steyer and Birch is the 10 degree color matching function as a starting point, okay? And transform this to the LAMS, the cone responses, okay? This is the 3x3 in the linear transform, okay? The modeling the fundamentals, right? Two parts. One is the length, okay? How our age correspond to the transmitting changes of the length, and also the macular pigments, the cone length considering the field length, okay? The field size, okay? So the current in the workflow, you start with your 10 degree observers, you transform to the LAMS, and then from the length, the pigment, this is give you the age and the corresponding results, okay? And then macular pigment functions, then it's considering, right, is that under 10 degree, what is the results? Cone photo pigments considering the age, and then you got the photo pigment sensitivity function, and from this, right, you can go all the way to predict the functions under the different, age and the cone fields, okay? Sorry, the viewing fields. And also, right, is the next stage. Once you got this, the cone matching functions corresponding to a particular field size, the age, then computing the color matching functions, and which can be applied in the typical applications, such as color difference and the color and color appearance predictions. Okay, so this is sort of field size and age in the consideration, some functions being applied there. Another, I think possibly the most important development for last year, right, is we are looking at the mesopic vision. The mesopic vision model is widely used. No, sorry, it's highly it's designed by the street lighting industry. You drive in the mesopic regions, okay? And how can you have the vision model to accurately predict its corresponding appearance, for example, okay? So we're talking about, right, it's in a very dark conditions. So we have the photopic functions, V lambda, okay? Scotopic, okay? This is the V dash lambda. So we are moving between these two fields, okay? So the general equation, right, is saying what is the factors, okay, which we can predict, and then we have this mixed adaptation conditions, okay? So this is a report only coming out the last week, okay? So now, right, it's it's a big promotion points, okay? The details can be found in the CIE publications. Now we talk about the color difference and the, okay, wow, I'm using that in the clock. Okay, right, CLAB and CLAF, okay, color difference evaluation. So over the years, right, people, most of us using the CLAB is still the current recommended uniform color space, okay? So if you look at what is after the 1976, so we have CMC, CIE94 formula. So there's no color space. It's a correction of the CLAB, okay? And then, right, it's lots of data being generated, and we realize the CLAB got a problem. Okay, it's not doing very well. So we had this sort of surgery correction, okay? A sick patient needs 5 or 6 you know, surgery in order to make it works. Okay, for the small to medium color difference in the equations. Okay, to predict in the small to medium, we're talking about a C lab less than 5 delta E. Okay, so the current proposal is the CIED 2000 is writing into the a standard. So all these ellipses, okay, and each from the center to the border of the ellipse, that means right is they have the equal color difference. If C lab is doing very well, all this plot in the C lab, they should be the constant circles. They are not. From the middle to the outside area, we're talking about the right is five times variations. Okay, so the red ellipses, these are the prediction from the CIED 2000. So you can see the right in general, the black and the red ellipses, they overlap quite well. Okay, so this is the CIED 2000. The current activities run, as I said, right. Look at C lab, it's being, everybody's modifying C lab, okay? Everybody's becoming surgery, okay, doctors, okay? So we're very good in correcting all this. But now we need a new color space really correspond to what, what we see, a uniform color space. The current proposals, D1919 and from Germany, OSA, Camo 2 UCS and IPT, okay? But hopefully next year, we will come out with one single model. TC163, okay, looking at the validity, change of the color differences, okay? I have the color difference 0.5, I have some color difference 20. So that's a very large color difference, very small color difference. What is the limit? Is there a limit of the color difference equation, okay? There's one TC is looking at it. That and then, and it found right. It's the D2000 is overall having a good and reasonable prediction throughout almost full range. Okay, so uniform color space right. You can see that the C lab okay, and this is the ellipses that I showed you before. On the right okay, this is the CAM02 UCS okay. This is one version of uniform color space. Now you can see right. Most of the ellipses. Now they become more or less the circle, okay? And then the same size in the different color areas, okay? So that is what we were striving for in the color science the field. And when we come in, right, if you don't know the color difference, you are not a color scientist, okay? So for many, many years, right, it's what we are striving for is what we try to achieve, right, is the equal circles, okay? And in all different color regions. And the same size as well, okay? Color appearance model, C-Lab is a color, a version of the color appearance model. You put in the XYZ, and then you define it's illuminant, okay? And then come out and ask the visual attributes, lightness, chroma, hue, okay, correspond to what you see, okay? But C-Lab is a very simple one. We are now, right, it's in the era of the color appearance model. Okay, it's being applied in many color management systems. People have applied this in the different viewing conditions. Okay, so because right, if you compare with CCAM02, okay, so you have XYZ values, you define it's illuminant, X no, Y no, Z no, and you define its luminance level, how dark, okay, it's luminance applied. YB is what is the background colors, and then what is the surrounding conditions. You can look at this in the cinema, complete darkness. You can look at it in this average lighting conditions, okay, or you look at your TV in the dim conditions, etc. Okay, so these are the additional parameters, right? It's used for defining the viewing happiness. So over the years, right, all these parameters now is better defined. We can use the recommended. We recommend the methods to define these parameters. So we come out, right, it's the brightness, lightness, colorfulness, chroma, saturation, hue angle, and the hue composition. This is mainly, right, to do with different applications. So for example, in the graphic arts, in the imaging area, we sometimes use the lightness, colorfulness, and the hue angle, okay? In the street lighting conditions, brightness, colorfulness, hue, okay? So different applications, you can select a set of attributes to form your own applications. Okay? So further work right has been done. So we extend the CKMO to color appearance model, also right to look into the uniform color space. So the results I've shown you already. So most of these ellipses now becomes the circles. Okay? But of course there are other and recommendations from the IPT, from the OSA, and from the DIN community. Okay? So you predict the different phenomena, chromatic adaptation, looking at the change of the luminance, Stevens effects, the luminance of brightness, Hunt effect, and we have the distinguished Professor Hunt here. Okay, many, many years now, everybody mentioned about Hunt effect. Who is the Hunt? Okay, Professor Hunt is just right and sitting there. Neutral background effect, okay, from the very bright to very dark, surround effect, as I mentioned, okay? So now, so for this year, no, for the last 3 years, right, the hottest topics now is in the color rendering index, okay? Why? At one hand, right, is the incandescent light phased out. You can't buy the bulb anymore, yeah? So you ask them, go to buy the compact fluorescent lamps, it's fine. Everybody bought it, applied it, and then they were not very happy, okay? It doesn't matter, you have no choice, you have no alternatives there, okay? So everybody say the future is LED. It's been mentioned right many years now. We're talking about almost 4 years now. Still, the right is not widely used. A lot to do with the costing, a lot to do with the point source. That's only point source. You try to make it the panel, make it uniform, make it efficient, which is difficult. But however, everybody is working on the indoor the daylight, the LED lighting. Okay, it's coming. So the current color rendering index, you predict the CRI, we call it, you go to the shop, you say CRI as above the 80, good, you know, right? However, okay, the LED, you know, current matrix to predict LED is about 70 to 80, okay? So the industry has the strong demand, right? It's in order to sell this, to convince the people like the designers, okay? I design these beautiful color combinations. Okay, under this lighting light source. Once put LED, now it's degraded, okay? So how can we come out with a new color rendering index? So we hope, right, to achieve something next year in Sun City, CIE Sun City, you know, Petronium meetings, South Africa, okay? But then, right, the key point, right, is so we have the proposal, again, using the CAMO to UCS, but the metrics not very important. Many data sets have been generated to evaluate, to truthfully evaluate the color fidelity performance, okay, color harmony performance, color discrimination performance, and also the memory color performance. Okay? People from a different stream, okay, they're thinking color rendering is not just a number, okay? It pass fail. So that's fine. Color fidelity has been used for many years. It's working, okay? And also, right, people in the applied areas, designers, all this, my color harmony needs to be preserved. Okay? People from the, you know, many in this, they believe, right, it's the memory color is important. And apple is the apple color throughout the all different illuminants. Okay? So many different approaches. Okay? So the sample set, okay, in order to predict the color rendering index, the sample set, what the sample set we should use? Very saturated colors to tell the color gamut, or uniform set representing the real world colors, okay? So we use Munsell, many, very few people using Munsell, okay? You can have the textiles, paint, printed colors, and all this. So this is the one area of the interest. Reference illuminance, the matrix, the measure, and the color, final color presentations. So these are the areas that we are working on. This is we're generating the momentum. Last week in Ghent, the CIE division meetings on color rendering index. Okay, it's a big in the battlefield. Outside was raining heavily. Okay, inside people's very serious. Okay, and very glad we finished this. Okay, so do I finish? Okay, all right, okay. So, and finally, right, Okay, I've been involved with color science research for some period. okay, this is my dream. Okay, my dream is basically saying, right, is in the whole family of the color matrices, okay, there are many different tools, okay, XYZ for color specification, DE2000 for color difference prediction, color appearance models, okay, and so whether we can unify this in the one roof, okay, so just like right, is you have the one filing cabinet, you have all the information there. If you want this application, you take this out, combination of these two, you form the one, application, and either can do the job well. That's the key, okay? So most of the color scientists, right, we generate the data, okay? We ask many observers to carry out the experiment, okay? And then, right, we develop the model, okay? So this is my own vision, right, is to look at the CKM02 for the extension. CKM02 is not perfect. This moment, there are some faults there, okay? Engineering problem, we are curing, we are doing amending this, engineering problems, okay? What it can do now, right, is if you can look at it, right, it includes basically chromatic adaptation transform. That is the important part, okay? So we transform, get the colors into a reference illuminant, okay? And then dynamic transform, looking at the luminance, dynamic range, okay? The color signal transform from this, we can adapt, it's a brightness and the illuminant adaptations. We come out with the different attributes. And then we can choose what are the attributes for that particular industry, okay? And finally, we can predict the color difference. So what are the typical application would be? Number one, color specification. Lightness, colorfulness, hue, or lightness, chroma, hue in these particular applications, okay? Color difference, okay? Delta E values, okay? So from very small, less than 0.5 delta E, small color differences, go all the way to 50 color differences. We're talking about a gray color against a white, okay? Color appearance, we try to do the color reproduction from the different viewing conditions, okay? Viewing the, cinema images, complete darkness, okay? And color rendering index, okay? So it's how can we quantify the rendering property of the light source, okay? Color inconstancy index, now it's being widely applied, so we push very hard, okay? Martin Spencer, for example, they have a seasonal color palette, okay? So previously, right, it's 20, 30 colors. They come out from their database, okay? I use these colors before, okay? I have this every five years cycling, okay? The fashion colors reappear, okay? But now, right, instead of using the old samples, the reflectance, now we can generate the, what we call color constant palette, based on the color inconsistency index. Okay, so every color needed to be stable across different illuminants. Okay, and the metamerism index is being mentioned, right? It's very important. We need to understand, right? It's what is the lighting quality? There's one kind of metamerism index. Okay, the same color difference really be consistent across the different illuminants, okay? Another one is the observer metamerism. How observer varies in different conditions, looking at the display, looking at the graphics, and also the cross-media color reproductions, okay? And whiteness, blackness, and vividness, okay? This is currently a student, okay? Is working on that, okay? So we have the whiteness index already. So whether that can be done, using the color appearance approach, blackness and vividness. Okay, the ones in yellow, this is what the desired. Okay, by industry. Okay, that's what not being done yet. Okay, so light source mode, field size, age, and unrelated, mesopic, simultaneous color contrast, spatial and temporal. Okay, so many people already working on, sorry, in this yellow topics, okay? But we need to just, you know, bring all the results together, okay? So, TC, what is next, right? It's TC172, right? Measuring appearance, okay. So what's that? Go beyond colors, okay? We need to go into the texture, go into the translucency, go into the, you know, gloss, okay? So what the designers see, what the customers see, right? It's not just color. It's look at the overall appearance. This includes the more than just color. So we need to go beyond colors, provide the metrology, and also, you know, visual response data for this, okay? So now that I'd like to conclude, right, is the vision section. We expect, right, that we are going to have a continuous field and aged color matching functions, okay? Mesopic vision model, standard spectral sensitivity, we have a color matching function to define the color, okay? And we need a spectral sensitivity function to standardize the spatial domain, okay? Have sensitivity for 3D images, okay, for 3D displays, that is the hot topics, okay? And health sensitivity for aging people. Okay, we are in the aging society. We need, right, to consider the well-being. Okay, even we now, right, is in that category. I'm sorry, Graham. Okay, and the practical applications, right, is that so we need to look at, right, is the visual performance. Okay, different age groups working in the same working in the room, real room. How can we improve the situation for the colors, right? New CIE color rendering index, new CIE uniform color space, new CIE whiteness index, and then CIE real color gamut, okay, representing the world of color gamuts, okay, and then and universal colorimetry, and finally go beyond colors, as I mentioned, right, is appearance, network, gloss, texture, translucency, and other parameters, and visual performance of real living environment. Okay, and finally, right, even considering to bring the color into the color psychology domain, okay, color emotion and color harmony, okay? So this is I conclude, okay, my talk, okay? I covered a lot, okay? But most of this to you, it's simple. If you have the experience, you have done that, okay? And I hope, you know, you find this, you know, interesting. Division one, we need more color scientists. So actually, my most important, right, is the PhD students. Okay, 100% PhD students are the most essential component to, you know, drive the CIE. Okay, we have many opportunities for you. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you.
We could have one very brief question.
Great.
Anyone? Yes.
It's not a question.
There's a microphone coming.
It's not a question, but a comment. I find very interesting, especially for the automotive vision application. I find the age-related change of response and the mesopic vision, I think, of key importance.
So you mentioned about your RGBP sensors in the camera, okay?
And it should be put in a display so that an aged person who can't see much out there
exactly.
Can easily recognize it on a display. How should things be processed so the display makes it easy for the aged driver to recognize the image information? So that's an interesting question.
Let's forget about the age at this moment, right? Just consider for the normal color vision observers, we are having problem to apply the mesopic in the vision. You saw that in the equation, very simple, V lambda and the V dash lambda, okay? But what is the adaptation parameters in between? It's a lot to do with the different adaptation. You're driving, you know, on the road. Sometimes you are under the light, sometimes you are under the shadow. So how do you adapt? So it's not static, but also temporal, okay? So and that's one issue. Another issue, right, is that to do with metrology, okay? All the measuring equipment dealing with the metropic, areas is at this moment under development. A lot of the new the imaging camera-based systems are coming. There's a lack of the metrology, so we're pushing Division 2 very hard. You got to have traceability systems to the imaging based measurements. Okay.